So, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome at the Institute of International Relations. I would like to introduce our guests. Our main guest today is Dr. Dan Schueftan. I will introduce him in more detail later. All of you had the opportunity to read his CV that is posted on our website as well, together with the invitation to this event. But before I do that, I'd like to pass the floor to our second guest, the ambassador of Israel to the Czech Republic, who will say a few introductory remarks. So, Gary, the floor is yours, please.
Okay, thank you very much, Director Peter Kratochvíl. I'll start straightforward. Honorable members of the Institute of International Relations, colleagues from the Diplomatic Corps, some friends, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I'm thankful to staff Mizhnarodnykh Stavu for accepting our proposal to have this event, to host this event, and I'm glad that I can deliver into your hands a great scholar of contemporary Middle East and ex-teacher of mine, the National Defense College of Israel, Professor Dan Schueftan. I'm sure that he will fascinate you, even if some of you may not necessarily agree with his opinions. Secondly, this lecture and debate attaching one of the imminent threats to the security of the EU, the radical Islam terrorism. As an Israeli diplomat, I would like to stress that we are part of the Middle East, which is, with a few exceptions, mostly a region of Islam. But we have an immense respect to Islam and would never finger point to this magnificent religion as a source of the threat we are speaking about, or will accuse Muslims or Arabs as general as supporters of the act of inhuman jihadist perversion of Islam. Having said that, I would like to mention the latest Foreign Affairs Council of EU conclusions. Last week, actually, which are apparently a first serious attempt to deal with this threat by strengthening partnerships with key countries, supporting capacity building, and countering radicalization and violent extremism. In this context, I would like to add that when it comes to identifying key countries for cooperation, one would expect that such candidates be willing to identify and stand up to the terrorism. Therefore, we should probably bless on what apparently is a very recent development, as it was reported yesterday in Turkish daily Hürriyet. The Turkish Foreign Ministry announced that months-long talks between Ankara and Washington to train and equip the moderate Syrian oppositions have been finalized and have yielded a draft of a memorandum of understanding. Also, Hürriyet informs that Turkish Chief of General Staff will represent Turkey at an important security meeting to be held in Saudi Arabia with the purpose of coordinating the joint military campaign against ISIL. Finally, the Turkey will be represented, was represented actually, yesterday at White House summit on countering violent extremism. I guess I don't have to explain here why this is a positive, even if long due development. Thirdly, a few words about the Israeli position. Terrorist attacks in Copenhagen last Saturday bear the same hallmarks as the murderous attacks in Paris in January, an attack by Islamist fundamentalists on a symbol of a free speech which is critical towards Islamist radicalism, followed by an assault on the Jewish site. I would like to distract us from the main topic, but history requires Europe to be particularly vigilant on the issue of anti-Semitism and to protect its Jews, to guarantee their physical security and to enable them to exercise their religion freely. The issues at stake when Jews and symbols of free speech are being targeted are the same. These are assaults against the basic values of freedom, democracy, and tolerance. Today, these values are being undermined by a jihadist ideology spreading fear through violence and aiming at whoever disagrees with them or thinks differently. The Western liberal democracy and the Jews have been designated by them as privileged targets. The recent events show once again that Islamist radicalism has nothing to do with so-called Israeli-Palestinian conflict. It's not the absence of a Palestinian state that bothers the jihadists, but rather the presence of free, pluralist, and democratic states. ISIS, Al-Qaeda, Hezbollah, Hamas, Boko Haram, Islamic Jihad, This organization is rooted in radical Islam, continued to terrorize the global community. Their actions demonstrate that terrorism knows no borders and no faith. The threat of jihadist terror is global, therefore the struggle against it must be global too. It has to encompass political, operational, and intelligence cooperation. Apologies for using this cliché, but democracies do have the duty to defend themselves against undemocratic forces seeking their destruction. On the regional scale, there is a growing cooperation of Israel with Egypt and Jordan. Although we have to take into account the growing Egyptian pressure on Hamas and Hamas' lack of cooperation with the international community, plans in the rehabilitation of Gaza may eventually lead to another round of violence, whether initiated by Hamas or by some more fanatical elements with Hamas approval. One of them, for the time being, just Al-Qaeda affiliated, is Ansar Beit al-Maqdas, which may decide to follow ISIS example for creating attention to its activities not only by chopping the heads and attacking Egyptian army units, but also as it did in the past by launching an attack on Israeli targets. Neither should we forget the role of Iran as the biggest supporter of terrorism in the Middle East, and it's hard to predict how, when, and where Tehran may use one of its proxies against Israel or against Jewish communities. To illustrate, only a week ago, Uruguay authorities confirmed that Iranian diplomat who was suspected on collecting intelligence for bombing attempt on Israeli embassy in Montevideo fled mysteriously in the last moment. And the disturbing news coming from Argentina is a sad reminder of the Iran-Hezbollah terrorism axis outreach. Finally, about the Czech Republic. As it was reported yesterday in the Czech press, the Chief of Staff, Petr Pavel, visited last weekend the Golan Heights to consider deployment of Czech soldiers in United Nations Disengagement Observers Force, UNDOF. And I'm sure that he was thoroughly briefed about the explosive mix of different terrorist organizations present just a few hundred meters from our border in Kibbutzim, Jabhat al-Nusra, and Hezbollah, being hostile to each other, still see eye to eye when it comes to Israel. We highly appreciate the Czech willingness to deploy observers in the Golan Heights, as it was already done in the framework of the MFO force in Sinai. This being said, we wouldn't like that even a single Czech or other foreign observer will be hurt, whether in this confrontation with Islamist terrorist organization on our borders, and even more in any future security arrangements vis-a-vis Palestinians. Israel's security is and will solely in our own hands, especially after we learned that unfortunate impact of international forces involvement in Afghanistan, Libya, and Iraq. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador, for this introduction, which I think will feed nicely into, I hope it will feed nicely into what Tam Schueftan will be talking about. Now, before I pass the floor to Dr. Schueftan, I'd like to say a few more words about him. Dr. Schueftan is the director of the National Security Studies Center at the University of Haifa and also the director of the International Graduate Program in National Security at the same university, but also a visiting professor 2012 to 2014 at Georgetown University in Washington, D.C. It is important to stress on this ground at the premises of the institute, which is an academic institution, that he has also published a number of monographs dealing with Middle Eastern issues, ranging from the discussion of Jordan to the most recent book, which I find particularly interesting, which is titled Palestinians in Israel, the Arab Minority and the Jewish State, which is highly topical at the moment prior to the Israeli election, where this question of the Jewish state is very much discussed. So with that, I'd like to open up the lecture. The title is Europe, Israel, and the Challenge of Radical Islam. And Dan, the floor is yours.
Thank you. First, I am delighted to be here in Prague, as I've already mentioned before we started here. It's my favorite city in Europe, not only because I think it's beautiful, but also because Czech Czechs, like Israelis, are a small people. The only difference is that we are stiff-necked and obstinate, and you're nice. And it works very well for stiff-necked people to come and see nice people. It's very nice on us. It's more of a problem for you. But I'm delighted to be here. I come here at least twice a year, very often three or four times a year. And I'm, as I said, it's a privilege to speak here. Let me address the subject here and start by saying that the problem is not Islam, not because Islam is a beautiful religion of peace and so on. This is what people usually say because it's politically correct, and I'm not very good when it comes to political correctness, as you will see in a minute. But because I don't know that there is anything like Islam or Judaism or Christianity in the sense that you can take a religion and you can say, here is the danger of this particular religion or the hope from another religion. When it comes to religions, the question is, how do you interpret this particular religion at a given time, at a given place? Islam 1400 years ago was very different than what it is today. Islam in the Middle East is very, 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 very different from what we know in Indonesia, in Bangladesh, in Iran. It's very, very diverse. I think that what we have in mind when we speak of radicalism, and I think we should speak of radicalism, and it is associated in a way with Islam, is about Arab radical Islam and to some extent Pakistani radical Islam. Not that there are no radical Islamic organizations in other parts of the Islamic world. They exist. By the way, there are Jewish radical organizations and Christian radical organizations. Only what you have in the Arab world is not something on the fringes. What you have in the Arab world when it comes to radicalism is very deep. And radicalism in the Arab world is not specific to Islamic radicalism. And I want to explain why Arabs, in the modern phase of their history, are so strongly attached to different radical movements, including Islamic radical movements. But it is radicalism that is more important than just the fact that at the moment it is in an Islamic way. It uses the Islamic vehicle. If you study the last 200 years, more or less since Napoleon came to the Middle East about 220 years ago, you will find that since that time, in the Arab world, there is an unbelievable demand for radicalism, and therefore also quite a lot of supply of radicalism. When something is very much in demand, you will find a lot of supply. For instance, if you are in demand of the Messiah, you have a very heavy supply of false messiahs. Because if everybody wants a Messiah, somebody will get up and say, hey, I'm the Messiah, follow me. So what I find interesting in the Arab world is, why is radicalism so popular in the Arab world? And just to demonstrate it, go back to the 1950s. Look at, this is more 70 years ago, 60 years ago. Look at the rise of Gamal Abdel Nasser. Here you have radical Arabs, not in the Islamic way. By the way, Gamal Abdel Nasser hanged Sayyid Qutb, namely the most important ideologist of the Muslim Brothers. So we're not speaking about the same radicalism, we're speaking about two radical movements competing, and the leader of one radical movement hanging the leader of the other radical movement. What we should look at when we see what is happening in the Arab world or in the Middle East, I'll speak of the distinction between the two in a moment, we find that there is an enormous demand for radicalism, be it national radicalism of the kind that we have seen under Gamal Abdel Nasser from the 1950s to the 1970s, or to the end of the 1960s, beginning of the 1970s, or be it the radicalism of Saddam Hussein, be it the radicalism of Hafez Assad. These are not Muslim radicals. They're radicals, but not Muslim radicals. And the question is why, when we look at 200 years of Arab recent history, we find so many radicals. And I think this can explain a lot, both about what is happening in the Middle East and what is happening in Europe. The main problem that sophisticated members of the Arab elite are engaged in discussion, more than anything else put together, one issue is, how is it possible that we, the Arabs, who used to be great, who used to lead the world in the 7th century, but hundreds of centuries later, for a very long period of time, how is it that we, that were the symbol of success, became, in the recent era of the last 200 years, the symbol of failure? And let me tell you something about this realization in the Arab world. Because the question is not, are you, objectively speaking, a failure or a success, but do you recognize yourself for being a failure or don't you? If you look at the Middle East in the last 200 years, particularly in the last few decades, you will find that the Arabs are the most outstanding example of failure anywhere in the world. Compared to their resources, compared to their opportunities, compared to their heritage, Arabs have failed in every objective that they set to themselves. Let me put it this way. You probably know the story from Greek mythology of King Midas. Everything he touched turned into gold. Everything the Arabs have touched in the last 200 years also turned into something. Gold, it is not. Now, the understanding that this is the reality only came in the last 15 or 20 years. And once you understand that you are a failure, then the failure becomes more painful. And let me give here two illustrations that will try to explain it. When I speak on Al Jazeera in Arabic, you may know that in Al Jazeera, I have more people listening to me than in any other station in the world, because about 60, 70, nobody knows exactly, but a huge portion of the Arab world is watching Al Jazeera. So when I speak on Al Jazeera in Arabic, I am a celebrity in Paris, because Arabs in Paris, as well as in, I haven't been to Baghdad recently or to Sana'a, and usually I have this problem when I want to visit an Arab capital city, I have to take with me the whole Israeli army, and that's very cumbersome. So, you know, it's not very helpful. But when I speak in Al Jazeera in Arabic, and I say the Arabs are a failure, I don't even know who I'm speaking to. I have a camera in my face. I don't have a monitor. Somebody on the other side says, yes, you're right. We are a failure. Today, it is politically incorrect to say it in European universities, in American universities, even in Israeli universities. But in the Arab world, you can say it very freely. There is a recognition. Now, I don't know how many of you watch cartoons. I very strongly recommend it, particularly Wild E. Coyote and the Roadrunner. You will notice that when you watch a cartoon, when somebody is running and he reaches an abyss, he will continue to run in the air until he looks down. And it is only when he realizes that he is in mid-air, he begins to fall. Watch it. Cartoons have very strict rules. Okay? Cartoons should be the beginning of the academic education of everybody, because there are very strict intellectual rules there. Arabs have been running in the air for 200 years. In the last 15 years, they look down. And now, they're in free fall. And here is the problem. I don't know if there is more than one sentence that I can start with the words, every Arab child. But here is this one sentence that can be so general. Every Arab child is brought up with the conviction, the self-evident conviction, the axiomatic conviction, that Arabs are destined for greatness. This is self-evident. This is given. And there are historic reasons for it, and if you're interested, we can go into it later in the Q&A period. It doesn't matter at the moment. But this is how this society builds its identity. We are great. We are destined to lead the world. Now, this is the world as it should have been. Now let's look at the world as it is, or even more important, as we know it to be. Namely, not only is it realistically so, we Arabs are aware that it is so. We are destined to be on top of everybody, and we are on the bottom of practically everything. This is a message that got home, particularly in 2001 to 2003. The United Nations, that usually does worthless things, there is one exception. In 2001 and 2002, they initiated what they called at the time the Human
Development
Report. And the Human Development Report did something very interesting. It took prominent people from different continents, and it let people of every civilization evaluate itself, not Americans evaluating Chinese, or, I don't know, Europeans evaluating Arabs. Chinese evaluating Chinese, Arabs evaluating Arabs, Americans evaluating Western culture. You have it. And they didn't take one index or two index. They took a variety of indexes, realizing that every index individually can be misleading. But if you have an index of indexes, and they did quite a good work there, you can judge what they called the human development scale. And when Arabs put themselves on their scale, on this scale, they came to the conclusion, along with anybody else, that they're very, very close to the bottom of the human development scale. And here is this tension. It is a tension between the world as it should have been and the world as it is. And the question is, if the gap is so enormous, how can you bridge such an enormous gap? Now, you have another civilization who had an enormous gap and is now in the process of bridging it. It is the Chinese. They're saying, we used to lead the world, we lost this position of leadership, let us work for 50 years, for 200 years, for as long as it takes. And one day, we will build ourselves to a point where everybody will recognize that we are fit to lead the world. This is one strategy. Another strategy is to say, we used to lead the world, now we are at the bottom of the barrel, if you don't agree with me, I'll blow your houses up. That's a different approach. If it works or not, I don't know. Let's see. I don't think it has very good chances. But what you see in the Arab world, the radicals doing, is not let us build the Arab society. Because what is happening in the Arab world is that things that used to be bad are getting worse. Constantly. All the time. Everywhere. Let me give you one example. Take 1950. Egypt, Singapore, South Korea, Taiwan, Israel were more or less on the same level. Since then, Egypt is going down here, and everybody else is going here. And the gap is getting bigger and bigger. Now, when the gap is unbridgeable, what is your conclusion? If you want to bridge it immediately, you cannot do it in an evolutionary way, you need to do it in a revolutionary way. For instance, if you own a nice apartment and you want a better apartment, you take another job and you work somewhat more, and Maybe you get a nicer car, a nicer apartment, whatever. But if you live in the street and you believe that you should be a billionaire, and this must happen now, the only way you can deal with it is to rob a bank. Okay? So when evolutionary means are too slow, too incremental, revolutionary ways are called for. Now, everything I've discussed until now has a name. It's called radicalism. Namely, you change things from the source, from the radix, from the very basis, and you change them when you get people to believe you that you can change it. And therefore, when an Arab comes to the Arab communities and he says, hey, we're in bad shape, let's do a little bit of this and a little bit of that, and let's work very hard, and then in one generation or two generations, things will improve, and very slowly we will build ourselves up, he will get zero support among Arabs. Let me give you one example of a person I consider a friend. I hope he considers me as one too. Salam Fayyad, the Prime Minister of the Palestinians for a long time, not now. This guy became Prime Minister because the Americans said, if you want billions of dollars from us, put Salam Fayyad in charge because he is not corrupt. He came from the World Bank and he really wants to build a Palestinian society. And Salam really wants to build a Palestinian society. And his support, his political support among Palestinians consists of his niece and his mother on Mondays when it is not raining. In other words, nobody supports him. Because he wanted to do with the Palestinians exactly what they need. But if you're Yasser Arafat, or if you're Saddam Hussein, or if you're Assad, or if you're Nasser, or if you're Jabhat al-Nusra or the Islamic State or whatever, and you say, today we are weak and nobody respects us. I promise you that if we take radical steps, everybody will at least fear us. So at least we will not be disregarded. This is the worst insult, if you disregard people. If you say, I don't have to bring him into my calculus, he is insignificant. We will show them that we can't, which is exactly why we see today the theater of beheadings. This is a theater. It is designed to say, you can't disregard us. You can hate us. You can bomb us. But you cannot disregard us. And we will show you. And why is it becoming so popular even among Arabs in Europe? Because it promises immediate solutions. Because it promises immediate satisfaction. Because it promises immediate satisfaction for the one thing that hurts more than anything else put together. And this did not start with Islam. Many different ideologies were used in order to explain it, including socialism, including fascism, including nationalism, and now religion. Now, are they more comfortable with religion than they were with, socialism? Yes. But the phenomenon is radicalism. Islamic radicalism is only one brand of radicalism. The Middle East has a very high premium for radicalism. Now, does this mean all Arabs are radical? Of course not. Does this even mean most Arabs are radical? No. Does this mean most Arab governments are radical? No. The question is, the problem is, the issue is, what happens when the radical comes around? What kind of immune system do the non-radicals have vis-a-vis the radical? And this is where the Arab world failed. Namely, the immune system was weak. Because when very serious, very impressive Arab leaders said, hey, this radicalism is dangerous, this will bring us down, this will destroy us, this is irresponsible, let's not do it, they were very often forced to do the extreme opposite of what they wanted. Let me give you an interesting example. Almost 50 years ago, it is fascinating. The second half of the 1960s, Nasser, the number one Arab radical, is being attacked by the Syrians who were somewhat less radical and said to him, liberate Palestine, namely destroy Israel. And Nasser comes out and he says, look, we're too weak. We will be defeated. Should we destroy Israel? Yes. Is Israel worthy of destruction? Yes. Should we kill all the Jews? Yes. But we are not strong enough to do it. So wait until we're strong enough. And he postpones it, and he postpones it, and he postpones it, until Nasser himself takes the step that makes the war inevitable, because he says, now I'm ready, I'm going to destroy Israel. And then he brings the soldiers into the Sinai, and you have the Six-Day War. In the same period, take King Hussein. King Hussein always had excellent relations with Israel. Not only good relations, intimate relations with Israel. Okay, we were discussing very, very closely issues that were tremendously important for both countries. And King Hussein doesn't want war. Not only he doesn't want war, he wants a strong Jewish state to defend the existence of Jordan. Because in the final analysis, when Jordan is threatened by Arab radicals, it is Israel that came again and again to save Jordan. So he has all the best motivations not to make war against Israel. And then one day, he flies to Cairo, comes back with an Egyptian general in his aircraft. When he lands in Amman, the Egyptian general is given command of the Jordanian army, and then the Jordanians start bombarding Jerusalem in 1967. Israel approaches King Hussein on three different levels, through the United States, through the United Nations, and through another channel that we had open to him. And we said to them, hey, you're bombarding our capital city. If you stop now, then we will not act against you. And his answer, I'm now quoting verbatim, his answer was, the chips are down, we are at war. Now, here is a person who wants peace, makes war, and does the right thing. This is the paradox. If I were King Hussein's consultant, I would tell him to do exactly what he did. Because you want peace, make war. Why? Because if he doesn't make war, his own people will kill him. And he came to the conclusion that he was not a very tall person, and if he loses about 12 inches of his top physical entity, it could be very unpleasant. So, making war is better than not making war, because if you don't make war, you are dead. And not only you are dead, but the kingdom of Jordan is finished. So he said, I make war, I will lose one bank of the River Jordan, the West Bank, but at least the West Bank will remain. If I don't make war, regardless if you win or lose, my people will kill me and destroy this country, and all will swear allegiance to Nasser, because Nasser is the great hero, he made war against Israel. The question is, in such a region, and by the way, you will see in a moment that it is relevant to Europe as much as it is relevant to Israel. Not what most people want, or what governments want, or what leaders of a community want, but can they withstand the pressure of their own radicals? Some societies can do it in a very effective way. Do we have radicals in Israel? Yes. Do we keep them at bay? Yes. Do we do it with a strong enough arm? No. But we're doing quite a good job, reasonable job. I think there's a better way of doing it, but that's reasonable, more or less. Do you have radicals in every country? I mean, go to the United States, look at the KKK. Go to fascists in Britain. Go to fascists in Sweden recently, or in Austria, okay? You have radicals everywhere. The question is the society strong enough to say to these radicals, we will not let you destroy us with your radicalism? This is the question. Now, radical Islam started growing in the Arab world when radical nationalism finally failed. Radical nationalism failed, or the recognition of its failure came when Nasser died, 1970. And you will see that in the 1970s, you have the rise of the radicals in Iran and the establishment of the Iranian Muslim state. By the way, helped by an American president who was clueless about the Middle East and believed that because the Shah had a secret police that was very cruel, like every secret police in this region, it's a good thing to substitute him with Khomeini because he's a humanist and an open-minded person. We have this misinterpretation of the Middle East coming again and again, primarily from the United States and Europe. And Islamic radicalism is very dangerous because this is a culture that people feel very comfortable with in the Arab world. With socialism, they didn't feel very comfortable. Most Arabs who called themselves socialism didn't know what socialism is. It was anti-American, and the Russians did it at the time, so for them it was a good idea. There wasn't something deep. The only place, this may interest you, the only place that you can find interesting socialist thinking was in the Popular Democratic Front for the Liberation of Palestine, a small splinter group within the Palestinians. Very, very small.
Christians.
And now, some of them, some of them Christians. And now, we are getting this phenomenon on a very large scale. Again, try to see it as an expression of radicalism, not as an expression of Islam, although this radicalism uses Islam as a vehicle. Okay? This is the important distinction to make. Now, let me make a few short comments, and I will leave most of the discussion for the Q&A, about how Europe and Israel are dealing with these problems. Now, in a way, it's easier for Israel because the threat is much bigger. And when the threat is much bigger, you don't have to convince people that a threat exists. In Europe, you still have a problem to explain that any threat exists, that evil in general can exist, because so many Europeans, delightfully less in the Czech Republic than in other places in the more western part of Europe, the perception is of Friede, Freude, Eierkuchen, you know, all we need to do is to sit together and sing Kumbaya. The term is American from John Baez, but I think the Europeans have adopted this idea of, you know, a very simple-minded perception that now we are in the era of peace, human rights, and we can all ride into the sunset and live happily ever after. Europe has a very interesting set of fairy tales. Now, I'm not against fairy tales. I want this to be understood here very clearly. I always like this particular fairy tale that ends, and then they got married and lived happily ever after, written by a bachelor, I'm sure. And fairy tales are nice. But when you get to be five or six, you grow up. And some continents find it difficult to grow up. I mean, it's so pleasant to live in a world of nice things. In Israel, we realize that when people all around us are saying, we want to destroy you and kill each and every one of us, it should be taken seriously. By the way, most others in the Arab world, and thank God there are others, who don't say, let us kill you now, are saying, because we are too weak. Okay? When you ask Mubarak, 3-4 years before he was deposed, why don't you make war against Israel? He didn't say, because we have a peace treaty. He said, because do you want to be defeated again by the Israelis? Don't do it. We have this experience and we don't want to be defeated again. So, when you have in the Middle East something called peace, it is a product of deterrence, not a product of the understanding that you should live and let live. Europe has, I think, the greatest achievement in modern times, namely that in Europe itself, you have a live and let live reality. I think this is a tremendous achievement. The question is, can you apply it to other parts of the world, or can you apply it in Europe for people who don't accept it? And here is your problem with radical Islam in Europe. Because of your tremendous achievement, I don't think any other event in the last part of the 20th century and the beginning of the 21st century is as impressive and as successful and as contributing to the best part of civilization as the ability of Europe to eliminate war in most of Europe most of the time. Okay? Not including the Ukraine, not including the Balkans, but even there, things are not as bad as they used to be. This is a tremendous achievement. But because of this achievement, you have in Europe something that you don't have as much in Israel, and namely, illusions. That if you're nice to people, and now that we also have in the United States a European president, President Obama, and you have this belief that is very prevalent in the United States, that in every Saddam Hussein there is a little Thomas Jefferson trying to come out. All we have to do is to help him a little because he had a difficult childhood. So let us bring democracy to the Middle East, which by the way shows that the United States has a great sense of humor. Okay? Bringing democracy, I was speaking in the Pentagon on the eve of the Iraq War, when they told me they want to come to Iraq to bring democracy. And I suggested to them, first come to Israel and bring patience to the Israelis. If you will bring patience to the Israelis, you can bring democracy to the Arab world. But try it on us first. You see, I have a sign on my desk and it says, God give me patience, but I want it right now. Okay? So, this idea, you come to the Middle East and then you fix things. And don't people realize that peace is better than war? And killing each other is not a good idea? They don't know it, so we will come there and tell them. For instance, they're killing each other. Gaddafi is killing people in Libya. So let the Europeans come to Libya and tell the Libyans, why don't you have a democracy? And then the Libyans will say, ah, what a great idea. How didn't we think about it? And then we will have democracy in Libya. Okay? The only difference in the Arab world is you either have one person that kills everybody else, or you have free enterprise. Everybody kills everybody. Okay? This is what you had before in Libya and have now in Libya. This is what you had in Syria and Iraq and you have now in Syria and Iraq. Free enterprise. Everybody kills everybody else. In the Middle East, you cannot live in this area and remain this kind of optimist cut off from reality. It's difficult. We have such Israelis. I think we should have, again, we want to develop a sense of humor too. But in Europe, it is much easier to believe in this, and therefore the recognition of the magnitude of the challenge and the recognition of the nature of the challenge is not here. Europeans have not learned enough that pluralism has its boundaries. If you're pluralistic without boundaries, you're committing suicide. Let me give you an example on a personal level. If you're having dinner and one person eats meat and the other one chicken and somebody else is a vegetarian, that's fine. But if you have another person and he says, I'm a cannibal, I would be careful. In other words, in the Middle East, when you're invited to dinner, you must ask yourself if you're on the guest list or on the menu. Okay? And when Europeans are saying, oh, let us open up everybody, multiculti, okay? Everybody will pursue its culture. So my culture is to beat women. It's my culture. It is their culture. This is the culture of the mainstream in the Arab world. Many of them treating their women like cattle. They come to Europe. The question is, if you say, go ahead, do whatever you do in your own culture, it's a cultural thing. Let me give you an interesting example. In India, you may have heard, I'm delighted to say it hardly exists today, the custom of sati, you know, burning widows alive. When somebody dies, his wife was burned alive. Nepal, as the governor of India, said, I forbid it. So they came to him and they said, how can you forbid it? It is a custom. He said, you know what? You're right. It is a custom. I cannot forbid it. But the Indians have a custom of burning widows alive. We, British, have a custom of hanging people who burn widows alive. So you proceed with your custom and then we will proceed with ours. Two customs. Okay? This is my idea of multiculti. Up to a certain line, certainly. This is what a pluralistic society is all about. You do your thing, I do my thing, let and let live. But if your let and live and let live means you don't let me live, thank you very much. In Israel, we don't have a problem understanding it. Most of us don't have a problem understanding it. And when you don't have a problem understanding it, when you're threatened, you employ self-defense. And then if people like what you do, fine. And if they don't like what you do, fine. So they won't like what you do. In Europe, you are less prepared for this kind of challenge because of your enormous success in settling issues among Europeans and in bringing in people from cultures who are willing to adapt themselves to the European culture and say, I left my country because my people have a bad life, I want a good life. The Europeans have a good life, so let me adopt the values that gave the Europeans a good life. Fine. That's great. And the success is enormous. And let me tell you, as an Israeli, every value Israelis are proud of, we've learned from Europe. Okay? So certainly we have tremendous respect for what is happening in Europe. But the question is, do you set the boundaries where they need to be? Also, the people who are threatening us are from without our society. We do have 1.2 million Arabs inside Israel, but they know that there are certain things, particularly engaging in violence, that will not be tolerated. And there is very little violence among Arabs in Israel who hate the very existence of Israel. Arab leaders in Israel almost unanimously say that Israel should not exist unless it becomes an Arab state. The animosity is enormous, unbelievable. But they know that they can say whatever they want, but if they engage in anything that is violent, we will do what needs to be done, and we have proven it so often that now they don't even try it. And that's not because they can't. In my university, there is the highest percentage among all Israeli universities of Arab students. We have more, the proportion of Arab students in my university is higher than the proportion of Arabs inside Israel. Many of my students for many years have been Arabs, okay? And there is a fierce political debate on campus, fine. Hardly ever the slightest sign of violence. And this is not because this society is not violent. When you go back to Arab villages, you will find violence on a very, 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 very high level. But they understand that when it comes to violence, this is where we draw the line. And when we draw the line, we will stand behind it. And if it doesn't look good on BBC, nothing from Israel looks good on BBC. So what? We can afford to disregard it. Okay? Would it be nice if everybody would appreciate what we are doing? Yes. Is there the slightest chance that there is a possibility that this will happen? No. So we deal with radicalism in a way that you will deal with radicalism after you learn your lesson. And let me perhaps end here with my definition of a pessimist. A pessimist is a well-informed optimist. Namely, the more experience you've had, the less you believe that things will be well by themselves or only with carrots. Carrots are very important. I wouldn't give them up. But if there are no sticks, the carrots are not as sweet as they can be. When the stick is there, you don't have to use it. If they know that you are willing to use it when you cross the line of violence, then you don't need to use it. And the more you're credible, the less you will have to use it. So I would go back to Teddy Roosevelt and his very well-known saying, speak softly and carry a big stick. If you carry it, you don't have to use it. If you have proven that you're willing to use it, you don't have to use it. And then you can secure a life that is the kind of civilized life that you want for yourself and for your children, even in an environment of radicalism. I think I've depressed people enough. And
to some extent, yes.
I hope so.
Thank you, Dan, for the very interesting, very controversial at moments,
I have to say,
lecture, which is what we like here at the Institute. I myself have a number of questions, but I will not misuse my right as the chair too much, and I'll first open the floor for the questions from the auditorium. So anyone, we have still about half an hour, so anyone who would like to pose any question regarding anything you've heard here, or any comments perhaps, now is the time. So please, yes, please always introduce yourself, your affiliation as well.
Good afternoon, my name is Václav Bozděk. I would like to ask you if you see any parallel between the Arabs and Russians, and if you see any parallel between radical Islam and radicalism in Russia and Putin, I think.
I am not knowledgeable enough about Russia to make the parallel. And I'm always amazed by people who know a lot about Russia and nothing about the Middle East coming to tell me what the Arabs are vis-a-vis the Russians. I can only say that what we see in Russia is an authoritarian regime. And it has some radical moves. But I don't think it is similar to the kind of radicalism that we see in the Middle East. But I don't know enough of it to give you an intelligent answer. But I can tell you one thing. The day the wall fell in 89, I bought an air ticket to Berlin, I took a car, and I spent weeks here in Eastern Europe. It was fascinating. I came to Prague at the time. And it was fascinating. And then when I came back, people asked me, what have you learned? I said, look, you know I'm not an expert in Europe, but let me tell you one thing that is very easy to see. The Czechs, Czechoslovakia at the time, will become a liberal democracy. Belarus will become a dictatorship. And Russia will be an authoritarian country. You don't need to be an expert. You look at the society. Okay? The problem in the Middle East is that Arabs don't have healthy societies. And here is the interesting paradox. Iran has a repulsive government, but a healthy society. I have great hopes about Iran. In the Arab world, we have societies that when they substitute the government, things get worse, not better.
Well, maybe Tunisia.
So Tunisia may be a ray of light. I hope very much. At the moment, it looks good. Okay? Although Ghanoushi, I know him personally, is a very shrewd guy. He's simply more sophisticated than the other radicals. He is as radical as Morsi. More radical, but smarter. Okay? As smart as Erdogan, and therefore as dangerous as Erdogan. The problem is with people who are radicals and look good. Erdogan used to look good. Now he's beginning to show what he is. But he used to look good. Again, Russia, you know, Churchill said something beautiful about Russia. Russia is a riddle wrapped up in mystery inside an enigma. For me, at least, this is the case.
Thank you. Thank you. Any other questions or comments? Yes.
Well, so I'm a former student of Dan Schueftan. Now I'm at the University of Economics.
And he still survived it.
And I have a question about Saudi Arabia, because as long as I'm concerned, there has been a certain, I want to say alliance, but a form of tolerance established between Israel. And my question is, do you think can it change after the death of King Abdullah?
I don't think anybody knows, including the new king. Saudi Arabia is an unbelievably complex structure, and you never know what kind of considerations come in. I can say one thing in terms of Saudi Arabia as an entity. The problem is I can't go into the guts of the political system of Saudi Arabia, because even the experts have some indications, but not more than that, and I'm not an expert on Saudi Arabia. But let me tell you this. Israel and Saudi Arabia have identical interests in three categories. A, they understand that Iran is a dangerous enemy. Actually, four categories. B, they understand that Erdogan is a potential enemy. C, they understand that the Muslim Brothers are a danger to the whole region on a very serious scale. And fourth, they understand that the President of the United States is clueless and cannot take one decision that is not wrong. Let me put it this way. If somebody would have commissioned a book by me, What Not to Do in the Middle East, Obama would sue me for plagiarism. Okay? I can't think of one mistake that he did not commit. I can't think of one move that he made that was not wrong. Oh yes, there is one exception, that he did not become involved in Syria. Okay, so he did the right thing for the wrong reasons. I don't care. It's fine with me. But the Saudis understand that in the Middle East, the pillar of stability, and this is what they want, for their own egotistic reasons and for a regime that is repulsive. Okay? But when you want to have some kind of stability, the three major powers are Egypt, Israel, and Saudi Arabia. they will get assistance from Morocco, Jordan, the United Arab Emirates, and others. But the axis of danger is Iran, Qatar, Syria, Assad, Syria, Hezbollah, Hamas, Erdogan, and being complicit without really understanding what he's doing, also President Obama. Europe is not even counted as one of the players because it is not a player. Okay, it doesn't play a major role in the Middle East. So we have a common interest with Saudi Arabia. Does it mean that you can have a partnership? No, because we have nothing in common as societies. We are the opposite in terms of societies, and Saudi Arabia is afraid that if its association with Israel is made public, it will be very dangerous for the ruling elite in Saudi Arabia. So, can Saudi Arabia help Egypt and thereby help Israel? Yes. Okay? If the Saudis would ask me, what is the best thing we could do for Israel? Say this is what they want. It's not what they want. But say this is what they would have wanted. I said, help Egypt. Okay? At the moment, you want a Middle East that doesn't look like Syria, all of it, your only hope is Egypt. If you want people not to slaughter each other in every square kilometer of the Middle East, help Egypt. Egypt is the hope of relative stability. Do I like the regime in Egypt? Of course not. It's a military dictatorship. Okay? But quoting Churchill now for the second time, when he was 85, they asked him, Sir Winston, how do you feel? He said, considering the alternatives, very well. Okay? So this is my response to Egypt and Saudi Arabia and Israel. For the United States, once America gets a president, the United States can pivot to Asia when the Middle East is dominated by the three existing powers, namely for stability, Egypt, Israel, and Saudi Arabia, or hopefully one day by the four real societies in the Middle East, namely Iran, Turkey, Israel, and Egypt. In the Middle East there are four countries, okay? Iran, Turkey, Egypt, and Israel. The rest is a misunderstanding, including Saudi Arabia, including Saudi Arabia. But at the moment, beggars can't be choosers.
Thank you. Thank you. I would now ask my question before we come to the others. One of those which I found quite interesting of the points you mentioned is, you know, you replaced the focus on radical religion by focus on religious radicalism. So it's basically radicalism is the essence and religion is the vehicle, which is a, you know, idea, for instance, promoted very much by Gilles Kepler, a number of scholars who deal with Arabists, who claim, yes, there is a continuity, socialism now replaced by religion. But then the question really that still I think is unanswered is how you define radicalism, because if I understood you correctly, you said this has to do something with revolution instead of evolution. But then let's take Saudi Arabia. Would you then consider the regime and its ideology radical, because it is clearly a conservative regime? So are you talking about a kind of conservative revolution? That would be the first question. And the second question, which I think is related, is then, you know, moving from descriptive to analytical, because you said now these societies are permeated so much by radicalism, but previously many centuries ago, they were not. They clearly were successful, in a sense. Now, how come the change is there? So, what you know, from just saying this is the case, which is a interesting hypothesis, which I'm not really convinced about, but still, moving to the question of causality. So, what caused it? And then, of course, from that, how we can remove it again? The second question.
Let me start with the second question, because I can't answer it because of time limitations. It is so important and so interesting that the only thing is I can direct you to a very good booklet by Bernard Lewis called What Went Wrong? In other words, he takes exactly your question, which is tremendously important, and asks what went wrong. One of the answers, I would read the book anyway, but one of the answers is that once the gates of ijtihad, namely the ability to rethink about issues and try to adjust them to changing challenges, once the gates of ijtihad were closed, it became a rigid, and by the way, we have it among Jews as well. I mean, look at the ultra-Orthodox. They can live only as parasites at the expense of somebody else, because somebody must defend them and somebody must finance them, because they're incapable of building anything that is of any value. They just stick very rigidly to a way of life that they believe represents at best the original thinking of some sacred idea. So there are so many answers to it, but I don't want to do injustice to this. Ask Mark, it takes me a semester, okay, to discuss it. But again, asking the right question is sometimes more important than immediately getting the answer. And this is certainly the right question. Concerning Saudi Arabia and radicalism or not radicalism, you see, I spent so many years in academia that I came to disrespect it. And we academics are obsessed with definitions. First, define it, and then I know one when I see one, okay? Now, Saudi Arabia is at the same time conservative and radical. It is conservative in the sense that it wants to conserve a certain social order that, by the way, is dysfunctional and can only work in Saudi Arabia because they have oil. I mean, if these people didn't have oil, they would all die of starvation. Okay? They would look like Yemen does today. And what you get in Yemen is people who have nothing to eat, but they have an average of 3 AK-47s per person. Now, I understand 2 AK-47s, you know? One is for weekends and one is for other days. But why would you want a third one? Okay? Because they're obsessed with a bravado. We have a gun, so we are a man, and if we are a man, our existence is of value. Okay? I'm sorry, this is not a different civilization. This is an inferior civilization. And one of our problems is to accept everything as just different. You know, a cannibal is different than a person who will, a vegetarian. And, you know, also definitions, because vegetarianism reminded me of it. If a vegetarian is a person that eats vegetables, what does a humanitarian eat? Okay, it's a very serious etymological question. So, I am not embarrassed by the fact that there are contradictions, because I'm trying to be, okay, an academic, I have to make a living, but also I'm trying to be an intelligent person. And again, ask Marek, I suggest to all my students that they listen to lectures like this. Namely, when education comes in one ear, common sense doesn't leave from the other. So I'm saying human existence is not, has a very strong element of dissonance. And here is a dissonance, you're right. They are conservative in terms of the way of life and the social order, and they are revolutionary in terms of teaching in their madrasas people who become the worst radicals. Because people take whatever is taught for them seriously. You know, one of the things I'm trying to tell young people is, whatever you're being told, don't take it too seriously. Take it with a grain of salt. Because if you want to bring it to the extreme or ad absurdum, then you get what you have in Saudi Arabia. A society that says let us educate our children in madrasas on the Wahhabi school of Islam. And then they say, you're not religious enough. And then you say, anybody who is not my religion is my enemy. And then you say, anybody who is not my exact part of the religion, I will kill. And this is exactly what is happening to the radicals inside the Arab world. One last comment here. We are so concerned about what radicals do to Western people that we forget that the worst thing is what they do to each other. They butcher each other on a scale that is unbelievable. I mean, look at what not only Sunnis and Shiites are doing, what these Sunnis are doing to these Shiites, what these Arabs are doing to other Arabs, what these Sunnis are doing to other Sunnis. And this happens when you take an idea to its extreme and you say, I need to be pure. I'm afraid of Puritans. Puritans in every religion. And I know it very well in Judaism and, because I live it, in Islam because I studied it, and in Christianity because I heard about it, but I know much less about it. You can take ideas, for instance, of personal freedom to the extreme of joining the KKK and saying very soon black helicopters of the United Nations will come and occupy America. You hear some of the militias there, you really think that you are on a different galaxy. So the two elements exist in Saudi Arabia, and very strongly so.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. Yes, please.
I'm Kratochvíl, my name. I'm from the Institute of International Relations at the Charles University. I just have two questions, both are pertaining to Islamic State.
Could you speak up, please?
Yes, I have two questions, and one is both are pertaining to Islamic State. And I wanted to ask you, do you think that the Islamic State per se is a direct threat to Israel? Or
is what?
Direct State, threat.
If it's a threat.
To Israel?
To Israel, yes.
No, no. Look, what is a threat to Israel? Then you can ask the second question, I'll forget it anyway, so I'd rather hear it when I'm finished with this one. Look, first of all, it is a threat in an indirect way. When you live in an area that is structurally unstable and violent and hostile, you don't want another element that is unstable and hostile and violent, okay? But in the direct sense, if they will challenge us, they cannot be half as bad as Hezbollah, as Hamas. Not that they cannot hurt Israel, but they'll have to stand in line to hurt Israel. In the Middle East, there are so many forces who want to hurt Israel that they have to wait their turn, okay? And by the time they come, somebody else will kill them and they will kill somebody else. So is it something that can have negative implications to Israel? Yes, but we have so many negative implications, we hardly notice.
Okay.
The other question?
The second question was, we are speaking always about foreign fighters coming from Europe, but there are many, many more foreign fighters from the Arab countries like Tunisia or Algeria or something. And I wanted to ask you, do you think that these foreign fighters, once coming back to Tunisia or to Algeria or something,
they're going to what?
If they're coming back to their countries, back to Tunisia, if they can destabilize these countries, and this can have a negative impact on Islam.
Look, the reason that you hear so much about the Europeans is that the Europeans care about Europeans, which is only natural. They don't care. Look, nobody cares when in Iraq you have thousands of people killed in a week or in a month, okay? But when one person gets killed in Europe, then Europeans care. And by the way, I don't see anything wrong with it. I mean, it's only human that you're interested much more in what relates to you. But they will definitely come back, because you see, the point is this, and this is very interesting. The only place where Arabs can have a good life is in a place where Arabs are not in power. In other words, in places where Arabs do not make the society. If they would open the gates of Europe and the United States and Israel, there would not be a single Arab left in the Arab world. They all want to have a good life. Where is a good life? Where Arabs don't determine anything. And then Arabs come there, and instead of learning how to live in a way that produced this good life, are ruining this good life. And here we come again to what I mentioned before. Is it true about the majority of Arabs in Europe? No! The problem is not that every Arab that comes is a radical, or that every Arab that comes, the majority of them are not. But they are not capable of fighting their own radicals. And let me explain why. It is because for an Arab, more than, and of course this is an ideal type in the Weberian sense, it doesn't apply to every individual. When an Arab sees somebody who is willing to sacrifice, he says to himself, he is a better Arab than me. And therefore, you will find when the majority of any society, except Pakistanis and Arabs, maybe there are other exceptions, I don't know, but certainly with the exception of Pakistanis and Arabs, other societies, when the overwhelming majority is against terrorism, somebody will call the police and say, hey, there is a terrorist, come here because he's a danger to my community. An Arab will say, this person is willing to sacrifice, he's a better Arab than myself. How dare I, you know, make... Now, there is also the element that the person informing the police may be killed. This is true. But in most cases, it is social pressure, much more than the threat of violence, that produces it. So, they will come here because here people will notice them. Here is something that is very difficult to explain, and we don't have enough time, but I'll mention it because it's very important. Very often, you see, I spend a very large portion of my life reading Arab political literature and speaking to Arabs. And in the last 15, 20 years, I hear more than ever before statements like, I know I cannot give my children a better life, so at least I'll ruin the life of yours. Okay? It is very much about the ability to hurt others. And when you hurt others, you're a hero. And no matter what a brutal, barbarian beast you are, you will be a hero to your society. The entire Palestinian society, with almost no exceptions, considers every terrorist, just because he's a terrorist, as a hero. His family gets a better status in their own environment. The person is immortalized. So why shouldn't a person who has done nothing with his life become a hero? He will become a hero by killing you. This is one of his... By the way, he will also go to heaven and meet 72 virgins. Okay? I don't know how he can handle the challenge when some of the parts he would need there, I have seen, left here. But, okay, as long as you believe that this is what will happen to you, I suggested dealing with it by, instead of having 72 virgins, you give him one 72-year-old virgin. I think this would have stopped the phenomenon. But unfortunately, they did not accept my view. And again, the question is not, is it the religion? I know so many Muslims who don't believe in it, who ridicule it, who look at it as what it is. It could be a symbol for something, but they realize, you know, that this is uncivilized to have this perception. Just because you kill somebody who's not a Muslim, you will immediately be... But the point is that the radicals take over because radicalism is so popular that they mobilize it against responsible people, very often the majority of responsible people.
Yes, thank you. One last round of questions. So let's collect all of them. I'll remind you if you forget.
Thank you.
So don't worry. One there and one there. Yes, please.
Good afternoon. At first, I would like to thank you for an interesting lecture. And sharing your honest view of the point.
It's called rude, but okay.
Thank you. You were talking about boundaries, and I would like to ask, how should we, which milestone we should choose like to identify our boundaries? And because people living in Europe are not we and they already. Muslim people live there for generation. And what should be the transparent strategy? How we should like set up the boundaries together? And do you think it is possible to set up like one boundaries for whole European Union or each country?
Yeah, I would probably add to that, because I noticed that you really very much stress the ethnicity, even when talking about Israeli Arabs. You are saying us and them, as if the Israeli Arabs were not you. So this is, I think, points to the, in the same direction.
Okay,
so
let me answer this question first, if I may, because I will forget all of it.
Yeah.
First of all, let me take your question. Arabs in Israel insist not to be called Israeli Arabs, because they say, we are not you. Okay? We have in Israel an Arabic-speaking minority, the Druze, who say we are delighted to be called Israeli Druze. We are Israelis, we want to identify with Israel, we defend Israel, we support Israel. Okay? So, it is not, and Israelis are delighted to call them Israelis, and nobody that I know would refer to the Druze as they. You have an enormous opposition among the Arab leadership of Arabs in Israel to Israelization. They say this is a dangerous process. We are becoming Israelis. This is dangerous. Okay? We must remain Arabs. And they say we are Arabs in Israel. This is the term that they've chosen. And they say Israeli citizenship was imposed on us. We didn't want it. It was imposed on us. So it is not something that we want, because we don't want Israel. You see, the entire Arab leadership, I think I could find for my latest book two exceptions, and it was very difficult, from thousands. The entire elites, not just the political elite, but the elites in Israel, have signed one of four documents. And all these documents have one in common. They say Israel should not have come into existence. Not only was it born in sin, it exists in sin. It will become legitimate only when it will become Arab. Okay? So this distinction, and by the way, this has nothing whatsoever to do with ethnicity. It is national identity. Okay? Because the definition of the we for the Arabs is national. It is not ethnic. Okay? Now,
but if I may just add, so, but you accept their position because you are reproducing it in your discourse.
Yes, look, I will call people what they call themselves. Mm-hmm. Okay? I cannot define the identity of somebody else. It's his business. If he defines his identity as not belonging to me, I will not say, please belong to me, or you have to belong to me. I'm not French. Okay? In France, you may know, they officially have no minorities. Okay? They say, if you're a French citizen, you're French, period. Okay? Go to Saint-Denis, speak to Arabs there and ask them. They will explain to you. Identity is something that people define, and by the way, definitions can change. Okay? Now, your question I find particularly interesting, because this is the essence of what an open society is all about. Namely, not coming one day, setting a border and saying, that's the border. This is something that needs to be discussed every day, modified every day, adjusted every day. If we were sitting here 100 years ago, discussing the rights of women, okay? You would say to me, why don't you let me vote? I'm so nice. And 100 years ago, it would sound great. And today it sounds ridiculous. I'm delighted that it sounds ridiculous. I'm a sexist, but that's a different story. Okay? But this is exactly what living in an open society is all about. Constantly discussing between the security of a society and the individual freedoms. What can you do before Asnaj and after Asnaj is called, right? What's his name? The guy who took...
WikiLeaks.
No, not WikiLeaks. The person from the CIA who took the...
Snowden.
Before Snowden or after Snowden? We are rediscussing it. Before Weimar Republic and after the Weimar Republic. We're rediscussing the question of what is a self-defending democracy. And if one day we say, this is the line forever, we are undermining the very essence of our society. It is a constant polylogue, not dialogue, constant polylogue in the society, trying to find something that everybody can live with. Now, do you need certain things that are universal? Yes. For instance, you can't treat your women like cattle. And I don't care where you come from. Okay? I will impose on you because you're being uncivilized. You're inferior. I don't care what your religion says. You want to live like Muhammad? Go to the Arabian Peninsula, hide under a camel. Don't come here. Okay? But this is one of the few things that you should be completely inflexible about. Okay? But there are many other things that you can be flexible about. You don't want to eat this food and another food. You don't. That's your business. You want to have kosher. I'm a Jew. I don't eat kosher. It doesn't taste well. I don't like eating kosher. Okay? Do I respect Jews who eat kosher? Yes. When they come to my place, will I give them plates made of paper so that they will not touch the thing, the net and the pig and whatever, and they can't? Fine. Okay, I don't mind. That's fine. It's their privilege to eat whatever they want. It's my privilege to eat whatever I want. So there are certain things that are obvious on one extreme, and there are very, very few things who are obvious on the other extreme. So the only universal things, I would say, are the very basic tenets of human rights. Europe today cannot accept that women will be treated in a way, the way they're treated in the Arab world. Okay?
Yeah, but, sorry, thank you. But it is, big deal, yes, it's obvious for us that we don't want to...
But it's happening. It's happening. It is allowed here. It is allowed in Europe. And I think it is a mistake. Let me perhaps tell you a story, if I may, because all academics... a few years ago, I met with the foreign minister of the Vatican. And the first thing I did, I told him a joke about Jesus Christ. And the Israeli ambassador who came with me slid under the table so that he completely disappeared. And it's only when the foreign minister was delighted with the joke and then called me in Israel to say that he told it to all the cardinals, so including the present pope, that we get relaxed. And then I said to him, look, I always wanted to start the sentence with the words, the pope and I. And I came to you to get your official seal of approval that I can start a specific sentence with the words, the pope and I. And here is the sentence. The Pope and I are outraged that the European Union has taken out of its constitution the passage saying that Europe is a product of Christian heritage. Everything that Europe contributed to each and every one of us was a product of Christian heritage. Okay? So you don't have to say Europe is a Christian entity. Okay? But you can say, and you should say, and you must say, and you should be proud to say, Europe is a product of the Christian heritage. If people are ashamed of their own heritage, they're committing cultural suicide. And I don't want Europe to commit cultural suicide. It's enough that it is committing demographic suicide. This is bad enough. Okay? I don't want cultural suicide in addition to it. Before the next question, let me just introduce a commercial, if I may. I have recently written an article about the national security challenges of Israel that will be published in March. And anybody who's interested in it, but it's 10,000 words, anybody who's interested in it, give me your email at the end of this meeting and I'll be delighted to send you the article. Now let's, after the commercials, we can go back to the program as advertised.
One last question, because we have another meeting in a couple of minutes, so please.
Thank you for the last question. I'm from the Hotel Savoy Metropolitan University. I would like to ask you which particular states from these rich oil countries supported this radical community? And why?
Which from which countries?
From this rich oil country.
Ah.
Yeah. And why these rich oil countries rather do not support, for instance, Afghanistan? That's my question.
The oil rich countries are basically trying to protect the existence of the very small minority that rules them. In many of the countries in the Persian Gulf, you have a small minority of citizens with a very large majority of foreign workers, or, as in Bahrain, for instance, a Sunni leadership with a Shiite majority. So they will subsidize anything that they believe will defend them from being taken over by people who can stop the very good life that they have. So basically they're paying protection money. You know, politics is very, very similar to organized crime. Okay? Particularly in areas like the Middle East, where you either kill your enemies or you bribe them. And they bribe the people who put them more in danger than anybody else, and very often they will bribe their enemies from one end and from the other end at the same time, because they have enough money to bribe everybody. They also bribe their citizens. When there is a problem, they give them more money, and for a while they have put oil on troubled water, and for a while they continue to exist. Also, their support of countries is a product of the same concern, and B, changes with time, because the question of who is in power in these countries is very important. And power changes in the Middle East in a very radical way. I mean, look at the way in Iran, from the Shah to Khomeini. Look in Egypt, from the army to the Muslim Brothers and back to the army. So they will pay those who at a given moment will save their regime. They are obsessed, for good reason from their point of view, with the question of keeping themselves and their princes and their system in power, because they know that a lot of the political mechanisms in the region undermine them.
Thank you, thank you. Unfortunately, we have to stop here. So I would like to thank you for the very lively debate, including the commercials. Please join me in thanking.